हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू माय फिजिक्स क्लास। दिस इज शुमी रॉय फ्रॉम टेक्नो इंडिया ग्रुप पब्लिक स्कूल शिलीगुड़ी। एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डू अवेयरनेस साइंस सॉल्यूशन ऑफ चैप्टर 4 हीट। इन आवर लास्ट क्लास वी हैव डन शॉर्ट आंसर टाइप क्वेश्चंस, ओके। एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद लॉन्ग आंसर टाइप क्वेश्चंस। So the first question is, explain how woolen cloth keeps us warm during cold winter days. Discuss why wearing more layers of clothing during winter keeps us warmer than wearing just one thick piece of clothing. So the answer is, wool is a poor conductor of heat. Woolen clothes stop the flow of heat from our body to the cold surroundings and keep us warm during cold winter days. As we know, wool is a poor conductor of heat. So, this woolen cloth will stop the flow of heat from our body. Because during winter season, our body has the same temperature in all the seasons. But during winter season, our body is hot, but the surrounding around us is, the surrounding where we live is cold. So, this woolen cloth will stop the flow of heat from our body, which is hot, and to the cold surrounding, which is cold. Okay, so this flow of heat is stopped with the help of woolen clothes. So we wear woolen clothes during winter. Next is, why we wear more layers of clothing during winter? Again, the same reason. When we wear more layer of clothing, the air gets trapped between the clothing layer and prevents heat loss from our body. As air is an insulator, so air will stop the flow of heat from our body, which is hot, to the cold surrounding, which is cold. Okay, so multiple layers keeps us warmer as compared to a single layer. So where if we are going to wear only a sweater, we are going to feel cold. But if we wear 2 to 3 layers of clothing, like first the waist, then the t-shirt or a shirt, then half sweater, then a coat, then it will keep us warmer, more warmer. So it is suggested that we have to wear more layers of clothing. Of course, the woolen cloth is also going to protect us, but if we wear more layers of clothing, it will keep our body more warmer. Now the next question. What is clinical thermometer? What is the range of a clinical thermometer? Explain why a clinical thermometer cannot be used to measure high temperatures. So firstly, we will define what is clinical thermometer. The thermometer used for measuring the temperature of human body is called clinical thermometer. Okay, so this type of thermometer which is used to measure the temperature of human body is called clinical thermometer. And we know that other name of clinical thermometer is doctor's thermometer or nurse thermometer, because it is specially designed to measure the temperature of human body. Okay, next, what is the range of clinical thermometer? The range of clinical thermometer is from 35 degrees Celsius to 42 degrees Celsius. It has a very short temperature range. The range is 35 degrees Celsius to 42 degrees Celsius. Now the question is, explain why a clinical thermometer cannot be used to measure high temperatures. Okay, for this, a clinical thermometer cannot be used to measure high temperature because it has been designed to measure only human body temperature, which varies over a short range. Our human body temperature varies for a very short range. Our human body temperature will never fall below 35 degrees Celsius, or it will never go above 42 degrees Celsius. So, the clinical thermometer are designed like that only. That the temperature range is very short. The temperature range is from 35 degrees Celsius to 42 degrees Celsius. Now, if we use this clinical thermometer to measure a high temperature, okay, then it can damage the thermometer because it has a very short temperature range for measuring a higher temperature. Let us take an example of boiling water. The temperature of boiling water is 100 degrees Celsius. There we cannot use a clinical thermometer because the clinical thermometer has a range of only 35 to 42 degrees Celsius. So if we are going to use the clinical thermometer to measure temperature of boiling water, then the thermometer can get damaged. So we have to never use clinical thermometer for measuring a high temperature liquid or something. Okay, so we have to never use this type of clinical thermometer to measure any high temperature, because they are specially designed to measure only human body temperature. Next question is, explain how the water in the beaker gets heated when a burner is kept below it. Draw a label diagram to illustrate your answer. So we have to explain this with the help of a diagram. So I have drawn a simple diagram there. See, when a burner is placed below the beaker, the heat of the burner is transferred to the beaker. Firstly, the heat is transferred to the beaker and beaker get heated. And as the beaker get heated, the water present in the beaker also get heated due to convection. Due to convection means first the first particles at the downside will get heated. Now due to convection, the hot particles moves up, the cold particles move down. Now this process continues and the complete water in the beaker get heated by the process of convection. By the process of convection means where the hot particles move up and the cold particles being heavy, they move down. And this process continues until the complete water in the beaker gets heated. Next question is, explain how all the air in the room gets heated when a room heater kept on the floor in the corner of the room. It's a table diagram to illustrate your answer. So, a convection heat up the room when a room heater is kept on
the floor in a corner is switched on. Hot air from the heater heats one part of the room by convection. And once convection current of hot air is set up, it is spread out in the room through radiation. So what happened when a heater is kept on the floor in the room and is switched on? The air near the heater get heated. Firstly, the air which is near to the heater get heated and it expands and it became lighter. Okay, because particles which get heat energy, they expand and they become lighter, they become less dense. This hot air which is being lighter rises above the top of the heater and carries its heat along with it. Okay, so the particles which are hot, the hot air rises up and it carries the heat along with it. Now the cold air from above sinks towards to the bottom of the heater to take the place of hot rising air. Okay, now this process continues. The hot air rises up, the cold air sinks down, and this process continues. This cold air also gets heated by the heater and rises upwards, carrying its heat upwards, and more cold air sinks downwards towards the heater. This process of hot air rising upward and cold air sinking downwards takes place again and again, due to which all the air in the rooms get heated uniformly after some time. This circulatory movement of air in the room, which hot air rises and cold air sinks again and again, are called convection currents. Thus, a room heater heats all the air in the room by setting up convection current in the air. So, by this process of convection, this whole room gets heated. Next question is, describe the blowing of sea breeze and land breeze in coastal areas with the help of label diagrams. So before starting the answer, we have to firstly know that what is known as breeze. So breeze means gentle wind, a slow moving wind. Okay, so the people who are living in coastal areas, they experience an interesting phenomena. Those phenomena are known as sea breeze and land breeze. Okay, and this sea breeze and land breeze depends on the transfer of heat in air by convection currents. Okay, so let us start. What is sea breeze first? So look at the diagram. Firstly, sea breeze, it occurs during daytime. So during daytime, when the sun shines, the solid land gets heated to a higher temperature.
much more quickly than the liquid sea water. The hot air over the land rises upwards and cool air from over the sea moves towards the land in the form of cool breeze. Means the hot air, the land which is warmer now in the daytime, so it produces hot air. The hot air from the land, it starts moving upwards. And the cool air from the sea moves towards the land. Okay, the hot air moves upward and the cool air from the sea moves towards the land. Here the breeze blowing from sea towards the land is called sea breeze, because here the cool air is coming from the sea towards the land. So it is known as sea breeze. And the opposite happens during the night. Now during night, at the night time, the hot land cools much faster. The land which was hot in the daytime, it becomes cool in the night much faster. It loses its temperature very soon and it becomes cool. But the sea water is still warmer. For the whole day, the sea water has now become warm. But the land has lost its all hotness and it has become cool. Now the opposite happens in the night. The hot air of the sea rises upwards. The warm air of the sea moves upwards. And the cool air from the land moves towards the sea. The hot air of the sea moves upward and the cool air from the land moves towards the sea. So this process also continues up to the next sun rises. Okay, so until the water becomes cool, this process continues. Now, the part of the coastal area which is giving a breeze, cool breeze, is the land. So, it is known as land breeze because the land is giving the cool air. So, it is known as land breeze. Okay, so this is the sea breeze and land breeze.
With this question, we will end today's class. Thank you for joining the class.